thing about, if there's anything good that comes out of the COVID, was the fact that we've all discovered that we can meet via Zoom. And I think it's going to change a whole lot of things when we do look at this in the future. I'm doing 3 and 4 of these a week. This week I'm doing 7 of them every day or every night. And plus you guys in on today. And then tonight I do Ham Nation at 8 o'clock. I love it. I love sharing the science of this hobby. And there's so much to it. And we just don't get to hear enough of it. And I title this the science of audio, but we get into a lot of things here, and we'll get started. But first, I'll give you a little bit of history. I went through some of that last time, but we're going to rush this through because I think most of you had remembered this. I started out when I was 10 years old playing the accordion and grew pretty quickly. My parents bought me a Hammond B3 in 52, and it went from there. I became the organist at the Fox Theater in St. Louis in 56. I was 15 years old, and things really began to grow. Now, what's important about this is that bottom right picture. Not only was I summoned to be the substitute organist, but we needed a couple of guys to help voice and tune about 4,000 pipes in that organ from 1 inch to 32 foot. And they all had to be, tuning was no problem. Octavely, just about anybody could keep them in tune. But harmonically, and what we're talking about, you have to be able to listen. Listening is a mental process. And you have to listen that the pipe next to the next to the next to the next, they all had the same harmonic value. They could, one couldn't be mushy and one couldn't be bright. You pick what it wanted to be, but they all had to be the same. And I carried on in 1956. I became a ham radio operator, and it was just, it became my college education. I still have that Harvey Wells. It's down over in the bottom here. Oh, come on here, dude. My camera wakes up and goes to sleep a lot. You can see it right there. That Harvey's still with me every morning on 3885. We're having fun on AM, of course, but I just really appreciated all the things that amateur radio gave me. And one night I'm listening around on the band, 6 meters. And this is 1956. And there was this ridiculous signal. Oh my gosh, it was terrible. And of course I'm listening on things like my Gonset communicators. They were priceless, and everybody had a Gonset communicator, and a few of us still do. But I couldn't figure out what this signal was. It was so distorted. And I understand I was only ham for a couple of weeks. I had an SX99. I pushed a button that was a BFO, and here comes, bingo, that single sideband I'd been hearing a lot about. Single sideband wasn't on 6 meters in those days, but this one was. Come to find out, after working him for several nights in a row, K0DGE was the guy, and he said, hey, you come into St. Louis to play at the Fox, why don't you stop and see me sometime? Well, I did that, and I rolled up in front of the address. It was KMOX Radio, the 50 KWS clear channel in the middle of the country, and I go in and find out Larry Burrows was the chief engineer, and here he is helping me. He took me under his wing. I said, would you build me one of those sideband rigs? This sounds fascinating. No, I can't do that. I'm going, why couldn't you? You built yours. He said, but I'm going to teach you how. And he did. It was the start of my incredible building career in ham radio. It started out, we had to build a Central Electronics 10B that had plug-in coils. We take the 14 megs out and wound that coil with a grid dip meter. He taught me how to use a grid dip meter, which I still have in use. And we wound a coil to 6 meters. But he then taught me how to build a 36 meg oscillator. We had to be able to plug that into the front instead of a crystal. Bingo, 14 and 36 is 50 megs. I was on single sideband. You'll see it there on the left. The station really started to grow quickly, and I was having way too much fun as a kid. But I had this loving parents. These parents were amazing. They weren't into electronics at all, but they allowed me to put up 110 foot Roan. I was 18 years old in our old Victorian home. There was a tall house, but I had a very special antenna I was going to use. It was a Telerex spiral ray. And the theory was that when signals leave your antenna, if you're horizontal, they sometimes don't end up horizontal at the receiving end. They might slip switch polarity three or four times. And honest to goodness, it worked because there was a lot less fade than usual. Well, I carried on with this project. I put up a pair of Telerex 2 meters. These are 15 elements on two, on 36 foot booms. And this was just way, way, way too fun. I was an antenna nut, but I built a 6 2 Thunderbolt in 1959. Give me a kilowatt and a half on 6 2 meters. And being the only side or one of the few sideband signals, I was sought after. People wouldn't know what I was doing. I was a technician for 17 years. I never listened below 6 meters. Didn't need to. The band was open all the time. When I say this today, a lot of guys go, yeah, right. No, it was true. It was amazing. The sunspot cycle was huge. And it was a historic event in ham radio. But one day I got a call from Bob Drake of the Drake Company. He said, are you the guy that's got that Thunderbolt and you got a big signal on 6 meters sideband? Yes, I am, sir. He said, we'd like for you to join our yearly meeting. We do a technical meeting once a year in the Biltmore Hotel down here. And what they do is they take all the furniture out of one of the floors at the Biltmore. And they have the Collins room, the Hallicrafter room, the Central Electronics, and all these guys were there, guys that I had read articles and saw pictures of, Wes Shum, Bill Halligan, Bob Drake, all of these guys were there, and you could walk in and out of all the rooms. And then they had in one of the banquet rooms have the technical talks. That Biltmore Hotel was in downtown Dayton, Ohio. It was the first of the Dayton Hamvention. There were 600 people there. And in 1964, it grew a little bit and they moved to Hera Arena. But I was there in the beginning days of the Biltmore. And it was just wonderful. Well, while I was there, there was this guy that came to me from the UK. And he said, you might be able to help us. We're looking for a station that would do a test on our new antenna. Would you be willing to do that? Right? No, it's not in my vocabulary. So let's go. And I had these loving parents. He sent over one of their 128 element J beams. It was amazing. The Motorola dealer was down the road from me. He came over to help me install it because I'm just a kid. I wasn't sure what was going on. He made sure it was. And one of my other friends, K9EBA, he was a construction engineer and had a crane. And that's how we put this up on a 50-foot tower. And it was just incredible. I was going nuts. The station grew and grew. But I also, in 1962, I built the first band switching transferter. So you could take your 20 meters out of your central electronics or anything else, and you ended up on 6 or 2 meters. And that drove my Thunderbolt. Well, I became an editor of CQ Magazine for the single sideband column. That was kind of interesting. You see, in those days, single sideband wasn't a big deal. It was very rare on VHF, and these columns each month help people to know how to build things and do stuff. So that all worked really well. Well, I, along with that Motorola dealer, he wanted me to build those transverters for the market. So we did. in 1962. It was called the Hallert. His name was Joe Hall, and it was his financing, and I was just the engineer, so to speak. The one on the right is a transverter, either 6 meters or 2 meters. On the left was an 829B, 100-watt final on the VHF. So it really started growing. I was a columnist for a VHF amateur, and we talked a lot about moon bounce because I did some moon bounce with my antenna, and things just went crazy. It was my college education. There's no question about it. Just building and building and building. What was so interesting is that I played 6 nights a week, played the organ in a Holiday Inn. They had a 4-star restaurant there. It was the largest Holiday Inn in the chain at that time, 600 rooms on one floor, and a 4-star German restaurant. And I started there in 59. But a year or so later, I was working. I built a pipe organ, and we put it in the restaurant there. And it was quite an attraction across the country. People would come there and spend the weekend organ fanatics, and away we went. And there's some of the stuff that we did at the Holiday Inn. And it was wonderful. But I got tired of all the playing. I'd been playing for about 15 years professionally, most all of it. And I started a little music shop in my hometown of Marissa, Illinois. And it became the rock and roll capital of the world. I really did. People from England, all over the country here, would come because I had all the instruments that you didn't find in most music shops. I was a Hammond organ dealer and customized Hammonds, cutting them in half so they didn't weigh so much. It just kept growing. But the bands discovered this crazy little guy with a soldering iron. I built a 30-inch bass speaker out of an Electrovoice Patrician speaker. And that was my first mixer. We didn't have things like that in the industry yet. And all kinds of groups were coming at me then to start renting Hammond organs, Janis Joplin, Jimi Hendrix band. You'll notice in that top picture of Vanilla Fudge, you'll see the 30-inch that he was using back there. It was just too much fun. But the Fox called me. They were giving away or throwing out their bass speakers. Well, Hams don't throw anything out. They were getting a new sound system. These things were installed in 1929 in the Fox, and they were 16-foot folded horns, Olsen bends, we called them. So I took those and others, and I was building a lot of really great sound systems using Macintosh really great amplifiers, phase linears and stuff like that. It was very high quality. And we were doing all kinds of acts, a lot of country acts, as you can see there, Dolly Parton, Jerry Lee Lewis, Jim Ed Brown, Buck Owens. And one day the Fox called me again in 1970. He said, "Hey, you still have those speakers?" I said, "I do." "Are they working?" I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Talk to this guy." The historic part of this, and it is rock and roll history, the Grateful Dead were on tour. Well, they weren't supposed to be on tour. They were starting out in New Orleans, going to go up in the East Coast with just 6 dates. But their sound guy, who owned all the gear, he was on probation from the state of California. The DEA and the FBI heard about it. So they go to the warehouse in New Orleans and they sat in the back row. Concert was over. The band came on to St. Louis, didn't have cell phones. And the sound man was left there to load the gear in the truck. When he finished, he got padlocked, not the truck, him. They took he and the truck and all the gear off. The group comes on to St. Louis, no cell phones, 4 o'clock, they get on the stage. What happened? Where's Owsley? Well, he's not here. They called back to California on the landline and found out he was in jail. What are you going to do? So that's when the Fox called me, said, "Talk to this guy." And this guy was Jerry Garcia. I told him I had Macintosh amps and Olsen bends and JBL speakers. He was freaked out. He said, "You have Macintosh amps? Nobody does." "Yeah, okay, bring it up here." And we did. You can go into Google and put "The Night Rock and Roll Sound Was Born." There was some guy there that night at that concert that wrote an article, and it got published all over the place. I didn't know it till much later on. I started receiving guys' comments about that article, because it really was the night that rock and roll sound was born. Nobody had been doing anything at that level. I didn't know it. I'm a Hammond organist. I'm a ham radio operator. What did I know? But it really started something. And that article and others hit the front page of Billboard magazine. Oh my goodness, look out. Here we go. And so I was getting phone calls from all kinds of people, and we were doing all these different bands, a lot of English bands. We did practically every concert Humble Pie did in America. Jethro Tull and Jeff Beck. We became really good friends with all these guys, Joan Baez, the Beach Boys, and Les Paul. And it just really grew. There's one for you. How many people know who that is? Nobody can ever guess it. That was the first tour that we did for them of ZZ Top without beards. We're still working with them, doing their microphones. They're great friends. If I couldn't be friends with these people, I didn't work with them. I'm very serious about that. Because you're looking at a guy that's never tasted beer, I've never smoked a cigarette, and for gosh sakes, never did any drugs. And that is a true story. But they all respected me for that, because when they got in front of me, we were talking about how to make them sound better. And they would come clean as ever. They wouldn't come all souped up. We wanted to get serious. I respected them for their talent. They respected me for my soldering iron. Well, all of a sudden, I get another phone call. Guy called me. He says, "Yeah, are you the guy with that PA?" And I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "I read about it in Billboard. We need it in Boston tomorrow night." I said, "That's not possible. Why?" I said, "Well, the problem is I'm on a tour with Chaka Khan, and so we can't do that. I just can't leave her." "Well, you find somebody to do it. We need you here." I said, "Well, here, there's another problem." "What's that?" "We were the first company to put the equipment in one truck, 40-foot semi in those days. Because all the other bands, one guy would have a Volkswagen van with the guitar amps, another guy would have one with lighting and so on, and they never got there at the same time. Sometimes the concerts didn't get off really well on time. But anyway, here I was. The managers loved me because a straight man in a crazy world, I had all the gear there at the right time. Well, who is this guy? It was the manager of The Who. And I said, "Well, I can't make it there." He said, "Sure you can." So I called a friend of mine in Chicago. He took over the rest of that tour. And I said, "Well, how am I going to get there? I can't drive in a day." He said, "You go to the airport and you rent a Tiger Air Freight. They'll drive your semi up and away you go." Well, it was the first and last time I've ever rented a 707 Tiger Air Freight. It was great because it was another historic concert. Those wonderful guys came over here, and we were with them for 6 years, did all their touring in those 6 years, both here and abroad. That's a sound system I had built for the Sun Company. There you'll see in the lower left, that was their sound man, Bobby Pridden. Still friends with all these guys, and they gave me a gold record for that tour. Well, I get a call the next time from Pete Townsend. He says, "I need you to come over here." So get on a TWA, head to London, go to his home on the Thames River. And the second story was this incredible studio. All these different guitars and amplifiers and things. That's where he did all of his dreaming. And in the upper right corner, you'll notice a little organ. It's a Lowry home organ, about $1,000 home organ. And that organ was what he did the Bob O'Reilly thing with. Wow. And it was incredible. Most recognizable songs in the history of rock and roll. And Pete and I really, we really became really good friends, and we still are, even today. He said, you know, quad sound is big right now. I'd like to know if you could build me a mixer that we could move Roger's voice around the hall. Well, I was working with a sister company, IES in London, and we were building this console, you see to the right, but we weren't too far that we couldn't add another couple of channels to the output. Bingo, it became the first mix that we could do quad sound with. And the way we went, it was crazy. And yeah, that's me, that's not a wig. I didn't have to do all of their things that they did, but I had to look like them. Here's one of the reasons Heil Sound was so successful. We had an artist that worked for us, and he'd do these renderings of what the stage was gonna look like, the setup was. One of my favorite pictures of all. Some guys took this and sent it to me. But I want you to notice, there's one of our monitor cabinets. So you can see the horn. It's a 250-watt driver about 6 feet from Pete's head. Right behind Mooney is another one. And why didn't they feed back? We're going to get into that. But monitors were really some of our most precious things we brought to the industry, because they weren't doing monitors at the time. Nobody was, but I figured it out. You know how I figured it out? Antenna theory. And we're going to show you in just a minute. We're just about through with all of the history stuff. We went on to build all kinds of things. I had 35 employees. We're building all these mixers and power amps. What was unique about all this is that they were modular. If you out on a tour and channel 6 went out, don't worry about it. When you bought it, you got a couple of spares. Away you go. We had our production lines going of all these different things. You'll see the talk box there in the lower left. Speakers. We had a fiberglass shop that we made our horns and stuff. Power amps down there. It was just wonderful in those days. And we built it all here. That line up in the right corner, you see, that's a line of today. We still use that same building, and that was still going even today. But I got really tired of some of this stuff, and focused on a few things back in ham radio. But before I did that, I had this one job with WB6ACU. It was Joe Walsh. We became hams on the second date into their James Gang tour we did. We found out we were hams. Wow. He said, hey, I got a new band called Barnstorm. It's a new band. You got to help me put it together. So we did. Started working on it. And he had recorded we call it the hook on that. Every record has a hook. There's one song you remember from a band. You mention a band and you'll say that song. Joe, it was Rocky Mountain Way. Peter Frampton, it was Show Me the Way, so on and so on. And he said, I recorded Rocky Mountain Way with a guy in Nashville, and he had just a little 3-inch speaker and a hose. And Dottie West and Bill West, her husband, they had built this little thing in the studio. It was really quiet, but it was enough for him to do Rocky Mountain Way. And he said, what are we going to do with that? Well, I had heard about another ham radio operator. There's a returning theme here, guys. A lot of things done today in the music industry was done because of hams. W6UK was Alvino Ray. He was the guitarist for the King family. His wife was one of the vocalists. And what he did, you remember the old World War II pilots' microphones? They couldn't have a microphone. It was too noisy. So what they did is they had this made up. It had little carbon elements, and you strap that on your throat. I'm sure you've all seen films of this. And as you would talk, it would modulate, and away you went. That's how communications went with fighter planes. Well, he put it on his wife, but he didn't use it like that. He took the microphone and plugged the output of his guitar in here. So when he played the guitar, it came across these little modules and it modulated his voice as the guitar. And so it was called the singing guitar. It was very cool. Well, it got several years. It was a big deal, but then it went away. Joe says, what are we going to do? I said, we're going to do something. To the left, we built five of these. We had our own fiberglass shop, and I had this little, it was actually a fan module to put a fan on the back of a phase linear. We put that driver in there, 250-watt JBL driver. Bingo, we had her made. Put in a high-pass filter, and the talk box was born. And I'm sure you all know about Joe. Well, we had done almost all of the shows for Humble Pie. When they first came over here, they had a really young guitarist, lead guitarist, Steve Marriott and Peter Frampton. A few years over here, their management pulled Peter out as a solo act. The management called me and said, I want you to make Peter sound really good like you did Humble Pie. And so I did. We become really, really good friends. And Peter, he had a young girl friend, American, and she was married in our home in Marissa. And a year or so later, she called me and she says, hey, I'm with Peter. And I need a Christmas present. Don't send me a guitar. He's got a lot of them. So what did I do? I sent her one of those five prototype talk boxes. And you know what happened to the rest of that history. Oh, my goodness. We're still great friends. And he's really something. But it went on. I mean, another ham radio involvement with a group called Bon Jovi. I used to work this guy on 40 meters late night, and he had a studio in New York. It was the studio. Barbara Streisand, Frank Sinatra, all these guys would record there. And he said, I need to talk to you about a hook. I said, what are you talking about? I got this nephew, and he's going to put together a rock and roll band. We need a hook to really get him going, because I can get him the contracts with the record company. What do I do about that? I said, well, I'll send you a talk box. And so I did. And so, of course, it was Bon Jovi. On and on and on. It was all because of ham radio. I mean, that was the whole key of this thing. Ham radio, to me, was golden. But take another 1 minute here. I got tired of touring. I'd done all those years, like 15 of them. And I just thought it was time. Punk rock came in, and some of the classic stuff that we had, we call it classic today, was kind of wiltering. So I, okay, goodbye. Sold all my systems, and I got into doing TVRO. Wow. Satellite television. This is 1978. It really wasn't happening just yet, but I put in over 2,000 of these dishes in Southern Illinois. But not only that, I went into home theater stuff. We were doing big home theaters. I'm not talking little bitty Radio Shack stuff. I'm talking about things with Macintosh, Pioneer, and clip speakers, JBL, all this kind of stuff. These are rooms that were $200,000 and $300,000. So it was serious stuff, and it just really, really went crazy from there. But during all this, I would go to the consumer electronics shows with theater and set it up for Pioneer and JBL and all that. I met up with the Hubbard family. The Hubbard family had the first contract or license, really, for the first K-band. And this meant that we could have entertainment from a little two-foot dish. And in 1991, they sent me one of the test units, and for almost 4 years, I was on their test bin of DirecTV, and I was doing television and radio too. I was on on KMOX radio here for 25 years, but I also was on ABC television. This was 1994. It was introduction of the public video from K-band, the DirecTV. And it just went crazy from there. But I also got tired of some of that. I was just doing a whole bunch of other things. And I said, you know what? It's time to come back to radio, because I hadn't been on in 12 years. So I did. I had some of my gear, put it together. But what happened to my car to Art Collins audio? What? Whoa. I was mesmerized. Like, what happened? I couldn't believe it, because what I was hearing stuff like this. And it was pretty awful. It's like, what happened? Well, I'm in my matching microphone with my Kenwood. Really? How come you sound bad? Well, I don't sound bad. Bill said I sound good. I meet him every morning. My buddies say I sound great. You don't have any articulation. You're distorting. No, it's clean. No, I don't think so. So I had a job in front of me. First of all, here's that matching microphone. Let me get this back to level. And I'm going to let you hear the difference of a real microphone. Here we go. I'm not playing games. I'm just unplugging a microphone. And here's your matching microphone. Of course, the gain has dropped something fierce, but it doesn't have any articulation. There's no transient response. It's all gone. But we lived with it because it was matching. The only matching in this microphone is the color. Serious. So I knew I had a job in front of me. Listen to the difference. I didn't change a thing. It all starts at the microphone. Why do we put up with this nonsense? Because that's all we had. And we think, well, it's got to be pretty good because it's matching. No, it's not. So my job before me got pretty serious. What happened was I got a call from Paul Klipsch. Paul Klipsch was the father of the folded horn. He was the guy that really kind of brought hi-fi audio into being. And he called me one day. I just couldn't believe it. This is like a god on the other end of this phone. What can I do for you, sir? He said, you the guy that's got that big PA, 10,000 watts or so? I said, yes, sir. He said, I don't want to come and see this. And he did. He flew his little Bonanza airplane up to Marissa, Illinois, and bingo, showed me his lab. It was in an old AT&T telephone exchange building that he had gotten after they escaped from there. And that's his folded horn. He was really famous for the corner horn. But wow, what he did was teach me. He didn't cut me off at the knees. We got in his airplane, flew back to Hope, Arkansas, and I'm telling you guys and gals, it was absolutely unbelievable. It started my whole education of audio and other phenomenons, phasing, all kinds of things like that. Bell Labs was referred to as the idea factory in the 1920s, and it was a consolidation of AT&T and Western Electric. They were the manufacturing arm of the Bell system. But they had 4,000 scientists and engineers assigned to this newly created Bell Telephone Labs. They were fully dedicated to researching how our ears worked and what frequencies were most important to understand. Why were they doing this? They put a telephone system up, New York, New Jersey, actually, two wires, and it went all the way across America to the coast. But every 50 miles, I always thought this was amazing, but it was true. Every 50 miles was a little relay station that made sure the audio was frequency stayed up. The voltage was 1.14. Everything was right. What did they do when they turned on the new telephone system? What did they hear? This is exactly what they heard. It's like, what happened? What happened to this audio? they couldn't figure it out. Well, what they did is they brought the 4,000 scientists into being to figure out what happened. A Dr. Fletcher and a Dr. Munson discovered that our ears are certainly not flat, and the perceived frequencies have to be there. You'll notice it looks like a ride at Disneyland. But what they discovered was that the maximum articulation is between 2 and 3K. What am I talking about? All I'm going to do, I should put a camera on this sometime to show you guys. I'm not playing games. I'm not here to play games. I'm here to bring you science. This is really, this isn't Bob Heil. This is science that we all should know. I was just blessed and fortunate that it was Paul Klipsch, the master, came to me. And I guess he liked me. I don't know. But we had so much fun together and he taught me so much. All I'm going to do, you know what the chart says, 2.5K, I'm taking it away. It's gone. It's all I did. That's all I did. I'll bring it back up. I'm just taking out 2.5K. So the F and the S and the P and the B. The F and the S and the P and the B all sound kind of alike, don't they? We have to have that for articulation. And if you don't have it, you're going to have real troubles trying to make it through pileups and stuff like that. But one of the whole problems is not only that, it's how to use a microphone. That's really important, because a lot of guys just they just talk in it. There is a way to use it properly. And what you have to do, first of all, you need to have a windscreen, not just some Radio Shack Walmart thing, because a lot of those are not acoustically transparent. I hear guys every once in a while, oh, that muff, that made your audio change. It better not. It better not. It's not acoustically transparent. If it did, if you put it on your microphone, nothing changed. That articulation is still there. It's all there. That's one of the things. But no matter what, everybody, please pay attention to this. It's science. You do not ever, ever, ever want to get a microphone more than 2 inches from your mouth, ever. Because when you do, you lose transient response. You lose dynamic range, you lose level, everything else. Here, check it out. I'm not touching anything, but here it goes. We put that baby out about 6 inches. And I know what you're saying. Oh, it's okay, Heil, I'll just crank up the gain. Really? Okay, I'm going to crank up the gain. Now what? Sounds like I'm in a barrel or I'm in a roller rink. This is not right. But when you bring it up to your mouth, wonderful things happen. I got to take the gain back down. Here's the deal. A piece of science. Every time you double the distance, you lose 6 decibel. Think about it. Man, you could be as much as 10 or 15 dB down by doing this crap. Cranking it up isn't going to help. Very simple. Very simple. We don't want to have anybody talking like this, but I hear it. I hear it on the air, and I'm not happy when I hear it, because somebody has not told them what the truth is. And so what my job was, I wanted to do something that we needed badly. Here we had all these new radios, big deal. But they all sounded pretty bad to me. Oh, match a microphone. Yeah, right. So I built the first equalization on ham radio in 1982. It was called the EQ200. I wrote an article in QST, and it was a build it yourself, but it backfired on me. I had closed the plan in 80 when I sold all my road systems. And I had to hire some of my girls back to solder because I had so many people calling me with orders. And, you know, people say, well, I got an equalizer. Yeah. Yeah, I bought it at Radio Shack or I bought it wherever. But you see, most mixers are made for music. The filters are set at 80 hertz, 10K hertz, and you have a level control, minus or plus, I understand, boost or cut. But look at that square box on the bottom. That's where you are, and it's not affecting it. So you wasted your money. So what I needed to do was to build a box where the low, just the low, was at 160 hertz, and the treble was up at where? 2.5K. Now, you could boost or cut it. You would want to probably notch the bass out a little, but you want to increase the heck out of the treble. It was a miracle box. It really was. Thousands and thousands of them were built. And I was so happy. I was so happy because we were able to hire back many of our employees, and we started building it. And it was all because we applied the knowledge from Paul Klipsch and my friend K0DGE, the engineer. So we really knew there was something else up. So in 84, I designed one of the most popular selling microphones, the Gold Line. It's still available. And it has elements that do just that. We roll off that low end and we increase the highs. Now, one of the interesting parts of this, probably one of the best demonstrations I could ever give you that you will remember and it will affect you, is about your bandwidth. Your transmitter only produces what you tell it to. So if you go cranking up a bunch of bass or you do some silly things, that's what you got. We have proved to you 2.5 is very important. And all of this stuff of the bass, you get these guys saying, oh, Heil, forget it. I want to be a big GJ, so I want to really sound bassy. Well, guess what? When you do that, you wiped out the mid-range. I didn't touch the mid-range. It's like a teeter-totter. When you have way too much bass, it overpowers this mid-range. So we want to balance this all out, but we want to elevate the mid-range. All I'm doing here is going to roll off the bass. That's all I did. I took it down to about minus six. So we don't have the balance is great for communications. You know, we're not a singer in a nightclub. But here's the real kick. Here's what your bandwidth looks like. We'll say it. I usually roll off at 1.9 or so, 3K on the top end, and I roll off the low end at about 160, 100, 200. Well, if you do all this full range nonsense with all the low end, remember what I told you, 2.5K is the baby, right? We only have so much RF. We can't do any more. But if I narrowed it up, look what happens. Uh-huh. Guess where it goes? It goes at 2.5K. So you have some very, very beautiful articulate audio. But if you don't take care of that and you just don't care where it goes and just lollygag it along, you're wasting a lot of RF out here, both ends. Just a simple piece of science about what we're doing. And it just really bugs me that we don't ever hear a lot about these things. It's really mind-boggling to me. And one of the other things is, let's talk about how to adjust your radio. In 1999, I got a letter from Dr. Inouye. He is the founder, president, CEO, whatever you want to call him, of ICOM in a way, ICOM Communications. He sent me a letter, had a picture of his station. It had my equalizer and my gold line. I'm going, whoa. And this is what he had to say. I'm thinking of new transmitter line, and I would like to include your EQ200. And so, Pro 1 through all ICOMs, 7300, 7610, the entire line, they all have my two-band EQ in them, bass and treble, 160 low end, 3K on the top, so you can adjust those. And that's so ever important. But then a lot of times, guys really don't know how to adjust it, so they leave it in the default mode. Oh boy, it drives me nuts. No, not the default mode. We went through a lot of trouble to design this and doctor in a way to put it in your, it's all there, use it. I just proved to you how important it is. Well, at the following Dayton, Dr. Hasegawa comes to me, the owner and president of Yaesu. I want to do it better. I said, really? Okay, we can. We could do a parametric. That'd be good. I said, well, hang on. You're going to have problem. What be the problem? Education. Nah, we take care of it. Well, they didn't. You see, we don't have two control knobs, cutter boost. I set the filter frequency. You can't change that. I set them at the right place for just two bands, didn't I? Proved that to you a minute ago. But what do we do with the parametric EQ? I will guarantee you the majority of guys that own Yaesu still have them in the default mode, and it just really drives me nuts because they have such a great tool, but nobody's helped them. Well, in the next couple of minutes, you, every one of you, you're going to learn how easy it is to adjust the parametric EQ. There are three filters. This has two filters, okay? You know, 160, 2.5K, okay? Well, what do you do with a parametric? You are the engineer. So there are three filters. There are not two controls, there are nine controls. Nine of them, count them all. So that's why a lot of guys go, just run it on the default. Oh, built in, stand fine. Yeah, but you could be a lot better, especially cutting pileups and stuff. Here you go. It's not about power, not about power at all. It's about audio. You take that first filter, there are three controls. These three filters have the same type of controls. The first control is bandwidth. Leave it at one octave, that's fine. The second one is the frequency. Now let's set it at 160 cycles, okay? All right, good. What's the third one? Of course it is, boost or cut. So you can boost or cut 160 hertz. You're gonna get rid of that low end. I just proved to you how important that is. Then we go to the second filter. That one, you're going to set the bandwidth at one octave. You can play with that octave a little bit. It just depends on how wide the bandwidth of that filter is. I just leave it at one. So what's the second control? Frequency, where are you going to put it? That's variable. I find that between 800 and 1,000 cycles, things get boxy sounding. Everything, it gets, I don't care what it is. I can listen to music and if it's equalized wrong, it's got this boxy sound. So you're gonna take that second filter, you're gonna set it about 800, 900 hertz. And what do you do with the third one? Notch it a little bit. Okay, that was pretty easy. Here comes the all important one. Not that they all aren't important. I said the all important. You set that at one octave. You just dial it up, 2.5K, 3K, something like that. and you increase it, maybe a lot. Bingo, was that hard? No, because everybody can understand it. But you have to be able to set up your rigs right. And if you don't do that, oh well. But it does depend on the microphone you're doing. Another thing that really bugs me is a lot of guys, they don't use their RF gain properly. That's really amazing to me. But here's a great video. And I want you to pay attention to what happens when we don't have the RF. Got rid of all that background noise.
That's pretty well the turn on when
it
used to be on package.
We want to do it on slow, not fast.
I don't enjoy the computer part of the running the computers at all like we used to.
So, if you haven't adjusted the RF gain, that's what you hear. And it's so sad because so many don't pay attention to that. And here's another great demo of that.
Right now, it's really old technology that just kind of got forgotten.
Or that gain.
And, somebody like Bob or
slow AGC.
Yeah.
The noise is gone.
About this old,
it's like he's on FM.
We used to do, and
we haven't lost any signal.
New, application, and it works great, you know. So
even in real low input situations, people that aren't very strong, it's the same deal. I don't care what the S meter reads. I never look at my S meter, but you want fast AGC so that attack is quick. Otherwise, it does that right? No, you don't want to do that. You want to do slow so that when a signal hits it, it takes a while to go away, but it does go away and it doesn't do that pulsing like fast. Sometimes mid is a good one if you have a radio that has mid. And the whole situation is that you adjust your transmit band filter. Most of them, you can do that. But these are things that really help you make a better signal. I want to close here on one of my favorite subjects. And it's about phasing. Everybody hears about it, but nobody really knows how fabulously important it is. Wes Shum was the first guy to bring single sideband to ham radio, 1948. It wasn't Art Collins. If you had a trivia contest and asked that question, everybody'd say Art. Nope, Art was 6 years later. How did he get rid of the carrier? And how did he get rid of the other sideband? And then when some idiot comes up on your frequency, the big carrier, how do you get rid of him? You hit the notch filter, goes away. How does a Yagi antenna work? Noise canceling headsets. How do the equalization filters work to reduce things? How does phasing work? Well, Dr. Yagi, when he designed the Yagi antenna, he didn't have computers and modeling. I don't know about this modeling stuff. I know. I don't. Okay. Put the dang thing up and find out. He came up with an idea to build a director a little shorter on the boom so far out. And he did this by experimentation. Then he did one a little longer behind, and that was a reflector. It would give him some 10, 15 dB of rear rejection. That's how it works. And everything is done like this. All the phasing stuff, it's relying on the cancellation. I had some property down in the Ozarks. I just left there. Of course, we never did leave this place, but it was a second home. I've always wanted to put up a phased array because it always sounded to me like, oh my gosh, I'm going to have to spend a gajillion dollars to do it. Well, no, it cost me about $30. I had a pair of dipoles. They were coaxial dipoles, just dipoles, inverted V. Doesn't make any difference about that. But I went down to the local telephone company, and they were tossing out these telephone poles. They take down poles that get broken or old, and 100-foot poles, and they end up with poles. I got some poles at 60 feet, and they were nothing. I had a ham that had a big winch and stuff, and he came out and dug the hole. Okay, so I have two different antennas. You can see 65 feet high and 65 foot apart is the 75 meter one. Halfway down there, I ran a messenger line, and 33 foot high and 33 foot apart is my 40 meter. It was absolutely amazing. Are you ready? Check this out. We have just completed the installation of a 75 meter phased array antenna system consisting of a pair of coaxial dipoles mounted atop a pair of 55 foot telephone poles. We put them in an inverted V fashion, and the poles are 64 foot apart. These are 500 foot from the operating position, fed with RG213. In order to make the antennas directive from east to west, we use a delay line of 43 foot here on 75 meters. It's switched in and out of the driven element, either east or west. The downlead length is 126 foot. We take all of that coax, the downlead length, the 43 foot phasing delay line, and mounted them in a container, one of the plastic container boxes that we actually buried. And just the top of it shows. It's all sealed, so it's waterproof. But that's the way we get to switch all the components from 500 foot using one of the Amatron RCS-8V remote switches. It really works well. Take a listen to how we can get at least 10 to 20 dB difference east to west.
Like a lot of people do, mine's usually 3 inches or so. It, you know, that's just after I get done mowing it. And I know, you know, probably, you know, we get a dry day. I'm going to have to lay out there and mow. That's just all there is to it. Because, you know, if you leave it that high, when it starts growing in at all, it gets looking ragged pretty quick. So it's to that point now. And
the system really performs on weak signals. Take a listen as we switch to the direction they're coming from. Also note the preamplifier makes no difference on 75 meters on this signal. The preamp will, of course, make the meter read higher. But in many cases, the preamplifier does not cause the weak signal to be more readable. Check it out.
Yeah, well, I see. They introduced display on it, and I don't know if that is their form of a portable, or what that is. Your wire, some of that hooked up to your computer, and then did you use your handheld to go through it?
Here's some great sounding AM stations, and we were getting about 20 dB front to back.
Well, when the leaves drop off, I'll start using it. Daryl, Richardson Digital Outreach Corner. I need to do that too. That'd be nice to have. And I was going to mention to you too about your pictures with the Fifi. I'd sent that out to a few friends, and one of my cousins that was.
Well, we were talking about situation to be able to get 10, 15 dB on 75 meters, and you just got the proof of it. And it cost all the only cost I had was the relay, and that's not a big deal. And that phasing line, 43 feet. So why doesn't everybody do it? And well, it takes a lot of space. Well, I agree with that. But there are a lot of times you can put up a 40 meter, it's 33 foot wide. A lot of people have homes that are wider than that. And I've had a few of my guys do this after they saw this. They said, wow. And they go up and put 33 foot wide and away to go. But man, it's amazing. But to me, phasing is amazing. I have the most incredible demonstration here in the end of this I want to do for you. I'm going to unplug this microphone. and I'm going to plug these guys in. Now, what I did here is I made a Y cable. Comes out of that main red cable, and I got two microphones. And these microphones are exactly the same. They're PR22s, my favorite microphone. Another one of your fellow countrymen, Paul Rogers, said to me, I want you to build me a microphone that's very articulate so I don't have to have equalization. My sound men change all the time. They don't know what's going on. So I did. PR22, it's great. It's what I use on my ham rig all the time. Well, I have two of them, and they're identical, and they're hooked up in parallel. If you had a signal and you're running 500 watts and you're not making the pileups, wow. What are you going to do? Well, I'm going to go buy a kilowatt. I'll get them. I'm going to double my power, really. How many decibel are you going to prove to him? 3. Really? Okay. You know how loud 3 dB is? You're about to learn. This isn't some kind of magic act. This isn't something that I want you to say, well, that's cool. I want you to say, holy smokes. I can get you 10 dB easily just with the right equalization. You don't have to spend much. Here we go. These are both the same. When I bring this one up to my mouth, let's see if you can hear it. 1, 2, 3. What? Remember what we talked about listening? It's a mental process. Do this for me, please. Close your eyes and let's really focus on this to see if you can hear a kilowatt go away. 3 dB. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. No, you didn't. You know why? The scientists tell you this. The human being cannot detect 3 decibel unless we're in some kind of an echo chamber, some very scientifically designed room. Maybe. But normally, no. So what I'm telling you to do, take that extra money, could be thousands. Take that extra money, give it to your wife so she can buy more purses and shoes. That'll be more good than that stupid amplifier that doesn't do a whole lot. Okay, really? Yeah, if you're going from 100 watts to a kilowatt, yeah, I'll give it to you, but not when you're doing 500 to a kilowatt. I hear that happening a lot, and that's really sad. But that's really not what I came here to tell you with this particular thing. I have a sweet little plug here. This little plug is backwards. Pin 2 is hooked to 3 and 3 is hooked to 2. And plug it together. Well, big deal, Heil. It still sounds exactly alike. Yes, it does. But they're out of phase. What happens when you take two signals out of phase?
Nothing. Nothing.
Nothing. They cancel. They're gone. Hello. Goodbye. Oh, they still work, but they're not working together because they're out of phase. This diaphragm is going down when I speak into it. This diaphragm is going up. They cancel each other. That's how the phased array works. That's how all of this stuff, that's how you got rid of the sideband. So many things. Let me unplug. Anytime I have an audience of ham radio operators, I let them see that. It's really not see, it's experience. It's amazing. And you just have to think about all the many, many, many things that can work. Joe Walsh and I, we had a home in California for about 6 years back in around 2004 or 2005. We just second home because I was working in the studios a lot and being there around with Joe. He said, I want you to build me a microphone. What's the problem? Well, I don't want these stupid microphones that I got to keep stuck into my nose. I can't move around. You know, you see it every day on TV, these entertainers. I got to have that ball mic stuck right here. First of all, it sounds bad. You say, well, how come it sounds good? It's like Rush Limbaugh. He's got this microphone, but he has $5,000 worth of processing that they have to go through. This is a true story, and it really bugs me. because guys will buy that microphone. They just think it's a living whatever, and it's not. So Joe said, I want you to build me a microphone. So I did. This is the PR40. Oh, I better. It has a lot of output. Okay. It's a wonderful microphone. First of all, he wanted a microphone that he didn't have to be stuck in front of his nose. It's 180 degrees and still didn't change anything. So you have to, don't have that right under your nose all the time. But the big deal, he said, remember that big antenna you had? I come through there and we get on 2 meters. I couldn't hear you when you moved that around. Why? Because tremendous amount of rear rejection. So do that to my microphone. So I did. Nobody's ever done it. Neumann, Shure, Electrovoice, you name it. None of them has ever done it at this level because this thing has 40 dB of rear rejection. When I talk in the back, I'm gone. Oh, it still works. Not doing anything but canceling. How did I do it? Hey, I'm not an engineer. I didn't go to an engineering school. I did it because of my antenna theory. What I did, first of all, we're the first and only company to build large dynamic elements. Everything else is a little 3/4 to an inch. That's it. This thing's 1.5 inches. It's big. And the only entrance they have for rear rejection are 4 little holes, 6 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock. Big deal. This one, I took the whole bottom out of that big element. So the diaphragm gets everything out of phase because it's coming in the back. I put it on a what I call a collection tube. It's just a frame to hold the element up there. And so all the mids, the lows, the highs, they all come up from different angles up the side panels. And we get this incredible, incredible rejection. And what's happened now is that we've got recording studios worldwide and broadcasters, Sirius Radio, they just bought 250 and tossed out their RE20s. That really hurts a lot of people that's got an ego for an RE20. Sorry. They're 65 years old and they weren't good then. You have to equalize the heck out of them. I didn't equalize this. This is straight in. And that's what's so great about this microphone. Plus all of the other things I showed you. Even Sheldon, you guys know about Sheldon, don't you? Big Bang Theory. He's got a podcast on the Sirius Network. And he said, I want one of those microphones, but I don't want a different. So I built him that black and gold. Oh, gosh. I know I've had way too much fun, but I also have learned so much. And the last thing that we want to go through is, what are you going to do about your receiver? What's going to happen? What do you mean? You know, I work for these companies, and I've been for years trying to tell them they need to do something. Oh, our receiver's fine. Got great sensitivity. So I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the audio. Because every one of them, $15,000 to $400, has 1 or 2 watts at 10% distortion. It drives me nuts. I listen, and I hear all that, and I go, ugh. So I did something about it because they weren't going to do it. So I did. And what we're doing is we want to increase that articulation. You've already learned how important that is, but you can't do anything with your receiver. You want to lower that distortion. Distortion drives me nuts, and it does you too. And you don't realize what you're listening. You think it's just noise. No, it really lessens the listener fatigue. But we have to be able to equalize the speakers. And the matching speaker, I know, it's a cheap little 50 cent. How do I know that work for these companies? It's a cheap little speaker. They put it in a metal box, paint it the same color, and guess what? Then they drive it with that stupid 1 watt at 10% distortion that drives me crazy. So I did something about it. This is an amazing product. And there's been a few things try, but nothing has the really great and there we go, the great acceptance and the way that it works. It just works so, so good. What we're going to do, I'm going to play you a digital copy off air. And what happens with this, not only is it for your receiver, all the, but it's got to record out. So you can take a plug, connect that to your computer and Audacity, and you got the most beautiful recordings and no Y cords or anything like that. It has two headphone amps, both of them, very low distortion. All of this stuff's around 0.1. And we can have left side here, right side here, if you have a hearing imbalance. This has been a miracle. We've sold several thousand of these, and so many guys will call me just praising it that they got their radio back because they couldn't hear if they have especially a hearing imbalance or if they have hearing aids. We could punch up, they needed 2.5 or logger and operator. So there's a lot of things you can use this for. But I'm going to play you some recordings that I did off air, and you're going to understand what we're talking about. The first one is D104. It's all highs, no lows, which isn't a big deal, but it shows you what can be done with this little box. It is all highs.
I had a lot of fun the other night.
Let's put some low end in it.
I thought, well, I wonder if I can copy that. It had about 30 words a minute, and so I speeded up the tape, and sure enough, I can copy it.
Remember what I say about equalization. It's got to be balanced. Without that, you don't have that balance.
It had about 30 words a minute.
So this allows you to do that. But the real deal is what's going to happen here, the DX signal in the noise. There's the way you hear it. All we're going to do is 2.5K. I'm going to take it away the way you hear it. It's difficult to understand. Not when you bring up 2.5. There's the way you hear it. And it's all about the right equalization. And we've made it very easy for you.
Single sideband signals that are mushy and bassy, difficult to understand. But you can add some speech articulation just by adding some 2.5 mid-range.
It's the way you hear him.
They're just not, it's not the same as a rig built, you know, just for 2 meter sideband.
The way you hear it.
Receivers will never compare. So it's kind of nice that, yeah, again, ICOM technology.
No question about it. And I'm so happy. It took me a couple of years to do this. A couple of companies tried to do it, failed. And we took care of it. Because it's got to be easy to operate. That's the other thing. It's so important with all of these things. But we're very, very happy with it. And last but not least is a speaker. Paul Clips written all over it. He taught me how to take a speaker outdoors, do a cone resonance on it, find out what the resonance of the cone. Then you somehow, it depends on what box you're building, adjust the speaker internally with either the right kind of insulations, foams, or baffles to make the speaker equal the speaker cone. No distortion, no phase distortion. The speaker should never move. If you ever see a speaker move, you got a problem. It's a 5-inch speaker, one of our own. It's a 3.5-inch titanium tweeter. But the big deal is the amplifier. It's 25 watts at 0.1. I told you it's been my whole thing all day. I hate distortion. And it just bugs me when people don't know how to get rid of it. Well, this is balanced line in, all production stuff that we do in the plant. We're so thrilled. And if it wasn't the Paul Clips, I wouldn't have been able to know how to do that. Other people, they just buy a thing from China, stick it in a box, and there you are. Nope, we're not going to do that. And working with these companies has been really something special. And Dr. Inoue asked me one time, you need to build a microphone for the ICOM. You know, ICOMs are very different. ICOMs have a very low gain preamp because all of their life from the 60s, they have been using a little electrets. Well, most electrets are garbage. And there's a big difference in them. So I said, build me one. So I did. And we have what we call the ICM, almost spells ICOM. And it's wonderful. It also has its own cable, my own cable, and our own connector. You can't plug it into anything else because it won't work. It's got to have that phantom power because all electrets have an FET inside. And so you need to power that. And the only radio that does that phantom power up the same lead is of course, ICOM. And we build headsets for this is the new one, our BM-17. It's a great piece. And then we have just come out with one for the handy talkie. And oh my, it's so good. I've had so many guys tell me, oh, you know, your stuff is great, but you need to do something for these stupid handy talkies. Well, I did. Not very expensive, but my God, does it work good. But, you know, there's all kinds of products out there with other people, but they don't have the research. They don't have the care. They don't have the production that we do. Then we get to the last piece, the cable and the connectors. What a bunch of junk. What am I talking about? Well, you know what I'm talking about. Since mid-60s, the CB craze came in and they used this connector. You know, it came on your matching microphone, got a little quarter inch ring. Try to put that into a TS-2000 that has recessed, got to use needle nose. I said, you know what? We're going to change that. And I did. Had to go to Foster, who owns the patent to that connector. And they give me the rights and we had to pay things, of course, but it's huge. I call it a stealth connector because that's just what it is. It's big. It's very firm. But the cable clamp on these little things that I just showed you, they don't work. You know, after a while, you got to put tape around them or whatever. I always laugh about it, but I shouldn't laugh because here, look what they did. This is stock out of Kenwood. Look what they do. They put that little stupid piece of rubber right there to make up because their cable clamp didn't work. Why? Because they use a clamp that's made for everything else. I have a clamp that I designed, we make, and it's perfect for our wire. It also has a second output for a push to talk line. The wire is amazing if you haven't used it. I solve more RF problems with our wire. Why? Well, first of all, the shield is 100% silver. So when you spread it apart, you don't end up with two little stupid leads. And it's 18 gauge, not 26. But now, what about the blue and the red? The black and the white, of course, that's a balanced audio. And all these transceivers have balanced audio if you know how to hook it up. All of our microphones are balanced, our PR series. And we have cables. And there again, I solve so many RFI problems just by switching to a balanced input with the proper cable. Because here's the secret, and it's not a secret, it's a science. That blue and red are DC push to talk. Every other single solitary cable, they're all in one shield. It gets me so ticked off. When you put that DC next to that very sensitive AC audio, what do you have? RFI like you can't believe. And so many times I will tell guys to find out what they're doing. I'll send them a piece of cable and they call me back and say, I don't have any more RFI. No. So we know it works. We sell tens of thousands of feet of that a month, all kinds of people buying it. Well, in finishing this whole thing, I'm very honored that we recently received a PhD degree. It was an honorary degree for music and electronics from Missouri U. And, you know, it's crazy because I barely made it through high school. I was making a lot of money as a kid. And I didn't go to school except just the number of days I had to be there. But I'm very honored by that. But of course, the chancellor said, hey, yeah, it took you 50 years to get this degree, but I learned it from ham radio. And I have to share it with all of you because I'm not seeing and hearing this kind of science. I hear companies giving you some hogwash about things, but they don't teach us. They don't give us things that make it play. And that's what's so important. And then all of our stuff, we're the only manufacturer in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. There's that board that was built in the UK for Quadrophenia that IES and I put together for Pete Townsend. And we've used it years past. And one of the white speaker was one of the monitor speakers. There again, we were the first people to do monitors because I was the guy that figured out how to take the monitor system out of phase from the microphone and it won't feed back. My God, we're running 1,000 watts on some of those monitor systems 6 feet away from it, won't feed back. Why? I learned it from ham radio. It's all about phase cancellation. So we're so thrilled. I really appreciate you having me. I always love coming and visiting. Anytime you want me back, let's pick out a subject. You've heard all of this, maybe some of it a couple of times maybe, but pick something and we'll spend a whole hour on how to set up the radio or whatever. Because I am so thrilled that we now by Zoom can share all of this stuff. Anybody have any questions they want to give? I'm here. You got to have something.
All right, brilliant, Bob. Thank you very much. And but just before we throw it open to questions, you said you've had a lot of fun playing with this stuff over the years. I think we had a lot of fun listening to you tonight, Bob. So who's going to go first with a question to Bob? And if I don't see you, just shout. Everyone being very shy. Who wants to go first? Wave at me. Yes, Gerald.
Yeah, just a quick one, Bob. I wonder if you happen to know which are the suppliers in UK that handle Heil stuff, because it seems to be quite a long cost, a high cost, I should say, ordering stuff from the States these days.
Well, Martin Lynch, Carriott, Waters and Stanton have been our dealer for years and years. Good friends with Peter and those guys. And I think Nevada's carrying it. There's several that carrying our gear, but I knew Waters and Stanton Martin Lynch for sure. They certainly are selling it because they buy a lot of it.
Right, thanks. I had a question for this week from somebody saying which are the best places to go to for it. So I'm going to try all three to see what they suggest.
There you Thank you very much, Bob. Thank you.
Okay, anyone else with a question to Bob? Yeah, Richard, RBG.
Yeah, good evening, Bob. Super presentation once again. One little question. How do you sort of reproduce the magical sound of a PR22 into a headset microphone? What's the technology behind that and the difference between the two?
Well, the headset is a different story. That's made for communications, and it's not going to be big full range stuff. We roll off the low end with it, and got a really nice peak at 2.5K. And when we designed the elements, well, that's the key to that, in that we're able to do that kind of structuring in the microphone element, which we don't want to do in our regular PR22s or PR40s or so on. And if it went by too quickly, here's what we're talking about. All of our Pro 7s and some of the others, they use that HC7 element. Look at it. It doesn't need any equalization. It sounds great. And that's because the element does it. When we build the element, we rolled it off. And I've been doing that for years. We did it with the HC5s and 4s back in 1980. I think we brought that out in 83 or 4. And ever since then, it's been the microphone for the DX crowd. In fact, here's a little piece of history. Let's see, where is it? Here it is. In 1985, I got a phone call from a guy in California, and he said, hey, we are putting together the group that's going to go to Navassa, and we need that, and for Clipperton, we need your element, because we were selling, just at first, I just sold the element. I wasn't building any hardware, because I didn't know where we were going with this. I was just coming out of the organ world. And so I built the HC fours and fives, and the fours and fives were, oh my gosh, they were really amazing. And we rolled things off very hard. And here's what it looks like. There again, we get called down a lot by guys that, why you build that stupid microphone? It sounds terrible. No, it doesn't. Not if you're working DX, not if you're other end of the pile up, because it puts all the power you have. Remember that balloon I showed you? It puts all the power you have at between 2,000 and 3,000 cycles. That's the key. And we built the headset. Call it the BM10. Maybe some of you have some. I still sell this. We took it off the market here, I don't know, about 10 years ago. We took it off the market, and man, I thought they were going to come at me with big clubs like, you got to put that back on the market. And so we did. And that's got our HC element in it, and it's wonderful. I also forgot to point out one thing. I read EHAM every day, because if I see somebody that's having a problem or not happy, don't go to EHAM and bitch. Come to me, because there's something wrong and we'll fix it. Here's one of them. Guys will say, oh, that darn Heil headset hurts my head. Well, he didn't read his instructions. What do you mean I didn't read my instructions? Because every one of our headset has a steel band underneath all of the padding. So if you need a bigger one, you just go bend it and you shape it to your head. If you need a pinhead like me, make it. You can adjust the pressure on your ears by adjusting the band. Every one of them have that feature, and you just have to adjust them properly. So we try to, I mean, I'm using this stuff every day, so I know what works, what doesn't work, and I put it on the market because it really should be there. And that's how I design all these things. But that probably should answer your question about the headsets, right?
Yeah, okie dokie, Bob. Yeah, and thank you for the boom clips that you've just sent me for the BM10s, which I use when I'm out portable. I've got a ProSet Plus, which I use with the 7700.
Yeah.
I've got the Traveller, which I use with the 7000.
Yeah.
And as you know, the 7000 audio with the stock mic leaves a lot to be desired.
Yep.
That little headset transforms it.
It does.
So thank you very much.
Like I say all the time, it starts at the microphone. And a lot of people don't realize that, because I got a microphone. Yes, but it's not right. Well, it's matching. It came in the box. Yeah. Working for these companies really woke me up, because I found out how much they don't care about things. Great engineers, but sometimes what you do with it, something else. But thank you very much.
With the BM10s that I use that portable with a little TS480.
Yeah.
And there's quite a bit of equalization in the 480. So you've quite a big range of what you can adjust with that little radio. Thank you very much. Back to you, Nick.
Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you, Richard. Yeah, Darren, BWB.
Yes. Good evening again, Bob. And as Richard just said, thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. I use the same headset in my shack as Richard on a 7800. But I also, from time to time, use the PR781. And whenever I use that one, everybody says I sound better on the headset. Now, I'm guessing I haven't got it set up right. Straight away, the one classic thing I am doing, I'm using it like a desk mic. So I'm probably a foot or so away from the microphone. And you've already said tonight, that's way too far. And yet you're shaking your head. I can see you doing it. I've learned that lesson straight away, so I will redress that. But do you think that's probably what the problem is? I say I'm getting better audio reports on a headset than I am on the 781.
You know, here, wait a minute. Where's that? What did I do with it? I thought I brought it in here. The 781, it's really this microphone. Oh, gosh, the other room. It's this microphone rolled off the low end under 50 hertz is really what it is. And like this one, if I get back here, look what I lost. Look what I lost. Not only level, but articulation. You have to be right here. Look at broadcasters. You know, if you pay attention to the broadcast industry, those guys are never more than a few inches from their microphone. Why? Well, it's because if they get any further away, they lose so much articulation. So you do have to be on it. What kind of transmitter are you using it into?
It's a 7800 ICOM.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
I think the biggest problem is, that's right. I noticed that earlier. As you say, it's just too far away. I used to have it on a boom, but I didn't like the thing in front of my face, which is why I moved on to a headset. And to be fair, 90% of the time now, I use a headset because I just find it more convenient to use. I also don't like all the background noise of the fans, etc. So on the headset, you lose all that. And I think Richard RBG is the same. He doesn't like all the noise in the shack. Yeah. So we both tend to be headset fans anyway.
There you go. Okay.
Anybody want to buy 781?
Thank you, Darren. I've got Anthony next and then Jeff after Anthony. Go on, Anthony.
Bob, that was absolutely wonderful presentation. Thank you very much. I would like to get your ideas. I'm guessing that most of your gear with the, what should I call them, tone controls or equalization, is done with analog circuitry. Now, I've been playing around a little bit with digital signal processing to try and get similar effects, but with very little success. Have you got any comments about digital versus analog?
Digital versus analog, right? That's your question?
Huh? Yeah, for signal processing, yeah.
I'm the wrong guy to ask because I'm an analog man in the digital world.
I guess you were.
I can't stand it because digital stuff has artifacts and I hear all that junk. Yeah. The analog is so much better.
I agree with you. Yes, I just wanted to get your views on whether you played around with the DSP equalizers or not.
You have to think also, I just turned 80 years old. I know I look like I'm 50 and act like I'm 12, but all my life, since I was 12 years old, I've been playing with analog audio and there's nothing like it. So the digital boys need to go away, you know, and it gets back into some, even the digital microphones, condensers. Oh my God, you don't want me to get off on condensers. I could be here all hour. I get really wild about that. A condenser should be, it's a scourge of the earth, should never be a condenser. Why? Because it's too sensitive. It has absolutely no pattern, picks up every darn thing in the room and two blocks away. You got to have a bunch of power to power it. Why do you need all that? Why do you think the broadcasters are going to PR40s and junk and everything else? Of course, you know why. But, oh boy, I got a condenser. Well, good for you. But it really isn't the way. And I don't know what, I think a lot of it is just, oh, I got a condenser. Okay. But they don't pay attention to what's happening with it. That's the whole sad part. And for God's sake, don't drop it on the ground.
Okay. Thanks very much, Bob. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Tony. Jeff, AUG. Yeah.
Hi there, Bob. Thank you for a good presentation once again. It's a long time since we met down at the Leicester Alley when you were on the Waterson Stanton stand many years ago.
Yeah.
And you were doing your demonstrations down there. Yeah. And you've continued to give input to the hobby, which is absolutely great. You answered my question a few minutes ago yourself. I was just going to say our congratulations in order on you becoming an octogenarian.
Yes. I love it.
Thank you, Bob.
It's Well, thank you guys. I really appreciate all this. Maybe we'll come back and pick a subject just to spend an hour on whatever, because it's a lot to talk about.
Indeed, Bob. Have we got anyone before we lose Bob? Have we got anyone got a final question? Yeah, Jeff, O-N-A-N-T.
Hello, everyone. Good evening, Bob. Yeah, thank you for just another interesting evening here. Just a question, maybe a personal question. What is your favorite ham band? What is your favorite antenna? And what is your favorite mode to work?
Oh boy, you're not going to like this probably. My favorite, absolute favorite band, and that's practical. I mean, I can work them all, but I don't have a great big antenna system. I got a Force 12 on top of the roof here at about maybe 35, 40 feet. And, you know, that covers all the upper if I need it. I don't have anything on 6 meters because you're looking at a guy that got spoiled by 16 years on 6 meters when it was beautiful. I mean, you could work the world with 5 or 10 watts. And today, 6 meters has become a grid square band. You cannot have a conversation. You cannot ask them what kind of gear they got. All they want to know, what's your grid square? See you. Wait a minute, come back, come. What's your grid square? I don't know what my grid square. Oh, you got to find out. You got to have, goodbye. And I'm not making this up. They get really rambunctious about the fact that they want to know where I am. Well, okay. They forget about the fact that 6 meters was the original experimentals band. And that's where I learned all this. And so I finally took the antenna down. I get so furious. I didn't. But my favorite band, huh? You really want to know, huh? Well, I told you a minute ago, but you might have missed it. It's that little guy right there. That Harvey Wells has a 922 beside it. I call that my antenna tuner. You see, an antenna tuner is not proper unless it's got at least a pair of 3500s and all kinds of 75A4. Mosley CM1, that's a very rare receiver. I could be here for an hour telling you about that. I met the guy that designed it for Carl Mosley. And of course, the 2B. And yes, I have a sixer. I also have a tour somewhere. But there's the other deal. I've had that since I built it in 1958. That's a 20A. I built the 10B first, but then I built a 20A. That's it. 600Ls way down there. Now you're talking. Think about this, young birds that's been into the hobby for a few years. There is a 1955 amplifier with no plate or load controls. It's band switching from 160 to 10, no tune with an 813 in it. So you see, some of us old dogs, we did some pretty cool things back in those days. But there's where I spend my mornings. There's also a very special, that's a Symmetrix 528E. Practically every radio station in the world has a processor like that. It's got compression, limiting, de-essing. I don't use any of that. All I'm after are those 9 controls of 3-band parametric. That's what's in the ASU. That's all I do. I adjust it once, I never touch it. And I'm using a PR22. Sometimes today, when I got on the air this morning, I was using the PR77. So that's where I do it all. Yeah, I've got all this stuff behind me. And once in a while, I'll get on and do something. I got another 922 down here. And you see, working for ICOM and Yaesu, they send me all these radios. That they took my 7800 away recently and sent me a 7851. And of course, the magical little box of the 7300. And over there is my 7610. Oh my God, what an incredible invention that thing is. So you put the ICM mic on a 7300 and you're uptown. But I just love AM, and I love all the stuff that goes with it, because most of the people on AM are builders, tinkerers, and that's why I'm there. But I get on once in a while. just people that I know or schedules that I make, stuff like that. It's all good. But thanks for asking.
That's 80 meters, or 80 meters more or less, most of the time. Thank you, Bob.
Okay.
Brilliant. Thank you, Jeff. And thank you, Bob. Right, Bob, I'm just going to say to everyone, to you, while everyone is here, thank you again for absolutely first-class presentation. On the chat, you probably haven't seen it, but people who haven't put their hands up have all been saying how much they enjoyed it. And I was particularly struck by one of the guys who just put a comment on saying, look, I haven't got much history in ham radio, and I don't know much about sound engineering, but I understood and enjoyed what it was you had to tell us. And I think that's the key. And I think the other key, Bob, that you gave us tonight is that, yeah, there's a lot of computer and software modeling around, and I'm sure it's got its place, but I don't think you can beat just playing with things and seeing what happens when you play. And I think that applies to antennas, as you told us, as much as it does to every other bit of the hobby. So, yeah, you know, your words on that are well received, I think, by all of us.
Well, thank you very much. And I appreciate all your time today. Did you record this? Did anybody record
this? Yes, we did, Bob. I'll send you the link. We'll put it up on our, we've got a YouTube channel. We'll put it up on there. And we've got guys that couldn't stay for the whole time and sent us a message saying we'll watch it tomorrow.
Yeah, so. I appreciate that. Anytime you want me back, we'll pick a subject. You've all know the history and so on, and pick something and do it. So I'm off to this. I got to record my show. I hope you guys might listen. This is a Saturday night at 7 o'clock my time. Of course, that's going to be pretty late there. I do a theater organ, a cinema organ to you guys on WTWW. That's a 200,000 watt shortwave on 5.08. And so I'm headed over there to record my show for this week. So I, you got 2 minutes. I'll fire that up as we waltz out the door.
Brilliant. Thank you, Bob.
Okay.
While you're doing that, can we show Bob our appreciation the normal way before he fires up his...
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Bob, and come back soon.
And congratulations on your 80th birthday. Life starts at 80.
Oh, heck, I have to wait a bit yet.
How's Denise, Gerald?
Oh, she's coming on all right. I've been in a couple of times while we've been on just to see if she's okay. So,
good.
Yeah, she's getting a bit better, Kevin. Thank you.
Okay. What actually did she do to herself? What?
Just fell over. I think. I don't. It was in the middle at night going to the toilet, and she just didn't watch where she was going.
Oh dear.
It's easy done, isn't it?
Yeah.
It certainly is.
Brilliant.
And again.
Play the game, Sam.
The microphone's working okay.
It works.
Bob, did you know Larry Ferrari?
Yes. Miss
yes,
him.
Yes, well, he rebuilt the Fox organ from Philadelphia.
Yes.
In the 50s, he was working on that. And he also was a ham.
Yes. Yeah.
I forget his call sign, but I remember that he was a ham. And during the World War II, while he was in the service, he used to get on Sunday mornings and play the organ here on the East Coast.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, I remember. Well, listen, guys and girls, thank you very much. And we'll look forward to returning.
Brilliant.
Thanks,
thank you,
Nick,
Bob.
For the invite.
Yep. Bye-bye.
Yeah, brilliant. Thanks, Bob.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Good luck, Bob.
Thank you very much, Bob.
Thank you.